radio coming out of this.
Oh.
Please, sir, I want some more.
What?
Please, sir, I want some more.
More?
Appreciated, Mrs. Corning. Why, these here paupers in this here parish don't appreciate me. Anti-parochial they are, madam. Anti-parochial. Why, we've given away a matter of 20 loaves and a cheese and a half this very blessed afternoon, and still them paupers is not contented.
Of course they're not, sweet Mr. Bumble. When would they be?
Very sweet indeed, madam.
Ah, but it is of my faith also not to be appreciated.
Oh, I must say, you're not appreciated.
I'm so fond of them. Kids, Mr. Bumble, you can't imagine. And they taunt me at every turn.
Mrs. Corny, ma'am, I must say that any child that could live with you in this home and not be proud of it is an idiot and don't deserve to live in it.
Mr. Bumble.
No, no, no. There's no use disguising the facts. They're idiots, all of them. And I'd gladly hang the whole lot of them myself. With pleasure.
Then you're a cruel man. A very hard-hearted man in all.
Cruel? Hard-hearted? Why?
Are you a hard-hearted woman, Mrs. Corning?
Dear me, what a very curious question coming from a single man. What would you want to know for?
Something special, then you couldn't say no. Did I nearly catch you smiling? Yes, I did, and it's beguiling. If your hand is close, I'll press it. Yes, you like it, come confess it. us, who could see us or could hear us. If I ask you, can I kiss you? Say, what will my pretty miss do?
Scream! Scream! Scream!
If I pinch one inch from your shy protective shell, can I uninch you? One inch, will my blightful buxom beauty let her suitor do his duty? Though this laugh ain't very large, dear, see it upon it, there's no charge, dear. Will you sit?
No, I shan't.
Will you sit?
I shall scream, for safety of my virtue, I shall scream. Though me as rather cozy, see my cheeks are getting rosy. You would have me in your power if I sat here for an hour.
I shall scream, scream, scream.
You're a naughty, bad man. If you think I can't be proper, prim, and haughty, I can. And you'll pardon if I mention, you must state your true intention.
Is there not another room here? If there were a bride and groom here, would there be?
Well, there might.
We shall see.
I shall scream at the thought of what you're thinking. I shall scream.
You will wonder where the scream went when we come to an agreement, as my lovey dove is chubby. Could she love a chubby hubby?
I shall scream, Mr. Bumble. I shall scream, Bumble Wumble. I shall scream, scream, scream.
Have you ever seen a Liberal terms, Mr. Sowerberry, liberal terms. That'll be £5, if you will.
Well, as a matter of fact, I was needing a boy.
Great, then accept. £5, please.
Cash upon liking, Mr. Bumble. Cash upon liking. Mrs. Sowerberry.
What?
Would you have the kindness to come in here a moment, dear?
Well, what is it?
I was just telling Mr. Bumble here.
Hello, Mr. Bumble.
Hello, Mrs. Sowerberry.
That we may consider taking this boy into the shop to help.
He's rather scrawny, don't you think?
Oh, yes, there's no denying that. But he'll grow, madam. Oh, he will grow.
I dare say he will, on our victuals and our drink. These workhouse boys are a waste of time. They always cost more to keep than what they're worth. Yet you men always think you know what's best. What are you going to do with him?
Well, my dear, there's an air of melancholy about the boy's face that is rather interesting. Yes, I think he would make a delightful coffin follower.
A what?
I don't mean for the grown-up services. Just for the children's practice. Why, a mute in proportions.
You might have a decent idea. Very well then, boy, what's your name?
Oliver. Oliver Twistnell.
A singular name.
Ah, yes, ma'am. One of my very own choosing.
Yours, Mr. Bumble?
Mine, Mrs. Sowerberry.
And how is that, Mr. Bumble?
Well, you see, the lad's poor mother came to us destitute, brought the child into the world, took one last glance at him, and died right there on the spot, without leaving so much as a forwarding name or address.
Dear, dear. Well, Oliver Twist, do you think you could look like that man up there on the wall?
Maybe, if I had a black hat.
Oh, forget about black hats.
The boy is quite right. Get the boy a top hat, Henry. Really. These things take you twice as long to do as anyone else. But yes, you might have a decent idea. Can you keep that expression for a long time, boy, with a crowd watching you?
Yes, Mom. I think so.
He's a born undertaker's mute. I can see him in a black silk suit. Following behind the funeral procession with his features fixed in a suitable expression. There'll be horses with black plumes to escort a
sleeping among coffins, do you? Doesn't matter. You can't sleep nowhere else.
Good evening, Mrs. Sullivan. Behave!
Better not say anymore, see?
Better not.
the cheek of it, the workhouse cheek of it. My mother, she says, she was a nice one, that she was. You know, workhouse, it can never be helped then, and it can't be helped now, and I'm very sorry for it. But you must know your mother was a downright fat.
What did you say?
A downright fat. It's a good thing she died when she did, or she'd be doing hard labor in prison.
My mother! Get in prison! Let her get me!
Part of the family, we've taken to you so strong. consider yourself well in. Consider yourself part of the furniture. There isn't a lot to spare. Who cares? Whatever we got, we try. If it's your chance to be, we should see some harder days. Empty lot of days. Wardrobes. How is the chance we'll meet somebody to foot the bill? Then the drinks are on the house. Consider yourself our mate. We don't wanna have no fuss. For after some consideration, we can stay. Consider yourself one of us. Consider yourself at home. Consider yourself part of the family. We've taken to you so strong. It's clear we're going to get along. Consider yourself well in. Consider yourself part of the family.
your intimate acquaintance.
Hey!
Leave him alone. We're very glad to see you all of us. Very. Dodger, get the sausages. Charlie, the plates. Come on now, hurry up.
Hey! They're still!
Shut up and drink your tea.
That's mine.
You're staring at the pocket handkerchiefs, eh, my dear? There are quite a few of them, aren't there? We've just hung them out, ready for the wash. The wash, boys!
Is this a laundry then, sir?
Well, not exactly, my boy. I suppose a laundry would be a very nice thing indeed. But our line of business pays a little better, don't it, boys? You see, Oliver. In this life, one thing counts. In the bank, large amounts. I'm afraid these don't grow on trees.
You've got to pick a pocket
or two. You've got to pick a pocket or two. Boys, you've got to pick a pocket or two. Say!
You've got to pick a pocket or two.
No!
Just a pocket!
all this. You vote for me, don't you?
Coffee watch.
Really scratched up a bit. Very nicely made. Genius workman, ain't he, Oliver?
Yes, very ingenious, sir.
Right. What have you got, my dear?
Nose rings.
Oh, they're very nice ones. Very. Yellow and blue. What do you have it? Embroidered them too well. So we'll have to pick the initials out with a needle. You'll have to learn how to do all this too, Oliver. Won't you, my boys, huh?
Yeah!
But in the meantime, you'll have to learn how to make waltz. Like Dodger and Charlie over here. You'll like that, won't you?
Oh, yes, Mr. Fagin. If you'll teach me.
Certainly, my boy. No fee. Just do whatever Charlie and Dodger do. Especially Dodger here. He's gonna play your regular little Phil Sykes.
My handkerchief. You're shooting for me, Pocket.
Why, yes, sir. I can just see the corner.
You can. Good. See if you can take it without me knowing. It's all yours, all right? Look at them all. More little treasures. I mean, who's gonna look after me in my old age? Who? Who? Will you? No! What are you doing, Wade? Can you sing? Quick, quick. Speak. I want to hear every detail you saw.
I couldn't sleep anymore, sir. I'm very sorry if I disturbed you.
Were you awake a moment ago?
No, sir.
2 minutes ago.
Not that I know, sir.
Be sure. Be
sure. All right, then. I'm sure.
All right, then. If you're sure, then I'm sure. Of course, I knew all along. I was just trying to frighten you. You're a brave boy. Brave boy, Oliver. All I've got to live on me old age. It's a terrible thing. Old age.
I can get up now, sir.
Oh, of course, of course. There's a basin of water over there. You might have a wash.
But I had a wash yesterday, sir.
Well, today's your birthday. Wash!
Hey, Faggot, are you awake up there?
Nancy. Wake up, boys, wake up.
The ladies are.
We'll have less of that if you don't mind. Where's the gin?
All in moderation, my dear. Too much gin can be a dangerous thing for a pure young girl.
And what's wrong with a drop of danger, Mr. Fagin? After all, it's the only bit of excitement we have around here. And who would deny us that small pleasure? Would you?
Well, what?
You wouldn't know quality if you saw it. None of you. Except mud. And I'll go last.
No, I'll go last.
I do anything for you, dear.
Back soon.
My sister will be back here to take her hat soon.
Thank you. patience. My name, Jump Duck, thumbing with his belly, bumped in to me in the alley. Now his eyes will never tell it. We'd never heard of my name. Warm flow, used to host the train. He could be my name in pain. Poor look, shame he was so green. Never was he seen.
First job today with Dodger. I'm afraid that he might say something and get us into trouble.
That's very likely. You're blown upon, Fagin.
And you see, if the game were up with us, then it'd be up with a great deal more. And it'd not be the worse for you, my than it would for me.
Well, then, somebody better find out what's been done or said. If he hasn't talked yet, there's still a chance we may be able to nab him without suspicion. We'll get him the second he walks out that door. Now, who's gonna go?
The very thing. Nancy, my dear, what do you say?
The very thing.
That won't do, Fagin, so there's no use trying it.
And just what do you mean by that remark?
What I say, Bill.
Why, Nancy, dear, you're just the person for it. Nobody knows that way knows a thing about you.
And as I don't want him to, neither, it's rather more no than yes with me, Bill.
She'll go, Fagin.
No, she won't, Fagin.
Yes! She'll go, Fagin. Go, boy. Get out of here, all of you!
doesn't say the things he should. He acts the way he thinks he should. But all the same, I play this game his way. As long as he needs me, I know where I must be. I'll cling on steady.
Take Lisa's tape.
doctor. You'll find a great improvement in the boy.
That, sir, is for me to decide.
Thank you, Miss Fedman. How are you feeling today, my boy?
Much better, thank you. May I stay here always, sir?
If you wish, my boy, if you wish. Is the doctor to see you now?
You are feeling a great deal better, are you not?
Yes, thank you, sir.
Yes, I know you are. You're hungry, too, aren't you?
Not really, sir.
I'm going to go to the bathroom, Mr.
No, I know you're not. He is not hungry, Mrs. Bennett.
No, doctor.
You're sleepy, aren't you?
No, sir.
No, you're not sleepy. Not thirsty, are you? Why, if that boy's thirsty, I'll eat my own head. Are you?
Yes, sir. Rather thirsty.
Just as I expected. It's quite natural for the boy to be thirsty. You may get him a little tea.
Do you think that I can get up now, sir?
Yes, I think you may. And take a bit of fresh air. Be sure the boy's not too warm, Miss Bedwin. But be sure he's not too cold, neither. Will you have the goodness?
Certainly, doctor.
You think I had to be up at the finale again, Oliver?
Doctor, do you notice the extraordinary likeness between Oliver's face and that portrait of my daughter Agnes?
I can't say that I do. I only know two sorts of boys, mealy-faced boys and beef-faced boys.
You mean I can't go to
the
bathroom?
And which is Oliver?
Why, he's mealy. Where did you say he came from?
Well, he was arrested this morning for stealing my pocket handkerchief.
What, sir?
Well, it was a mistake, really. When the shopkeeper told us what happened, he was released by the magistrates to me. I brought him here to make what amends I could, but I find myself strangely drawn to the child.
He's deceiving you, my good friend. He has had a fever. What of that? Fevers are not particular to good people, are they? Bad people have had fevers sometimes, haven't they? He stole your pocket handkerchief, didn't he? Well, then he'll steal more, sir.
But he didn't.
Here are the books you ordered from the bookstore, sir.
Yes, thank you. Now, I've got some other... Dear, the boy left, and I particularly wish to have some books returned today.
Send Oliver with him. He'll be sure to deliver them safely. Why, if he does, I'll eat my own head.
Yes, sir. Do let me take them for you. Please, sir.
Yes, if you wish, you shall, my boy. Now, here's what I want you to do. I want you to take those books over there to the bookseller until you've come to pay the £4.10 that Mr. Brownlow owes. This is a £5 note. Now, you don't need to rush. It's just on the street, but I shall expect you back in 10 minutes.
Very good, sir. Thank you.
Shall we see Miss Benjamin? 10 minutes?
Come home to your poor mother, you young dog. What books are these?
They're Mr. Brownlow's.
So you've been stealing again, have you? Give him a ear. He's nothing but a thief and a vagabond. Come home to your mother, you young villain.
Oh,
spoil them, but why didn't you come and tell us if you were coming? I mean, you were prepared to be more for someone.
Hello, what's that? That's mine, Fagin.
No, no, it's mine, mine. You can have the books.
If that ain't mine, mine announces that I'll take the boy back again. Now give it here.
This is hardly fair, Bill.
Fair or not fair? Hardly fair, is it, Nancy? Do you think me and Nancy's got nothing better to do with your precious time than spend it chasing after young kids? Let's all share the trouble and not half enough either. Start a library.
You can't take the books. They belong to Mr. Brownlow. And if he finds out that you have them, he'll be out here after you.
So he'll be out here, will he? What'd you tell him about us?
Nothing.
That remains to be seen. But if I find out you said anything, anything out of place, I'll wager that young scoundrel's will never be.
I'm on the best.
Stand off of me or I'll split your head against the wall.
I don't care for that, Bill. The child shan't be harmed unless you kill me first.
Shanty, I'll soon be doing that if you don't stand off.
Bill, what's the matter, huh? I mean, we've got the boy, huh? What's the matter?
The girl's gone mad, I think.
No, she hasn't, Fagin. Don't think it.
You keep quiet, will you?
No, I won't keep quiet. I won't stand by and see it done, Bill. You've got him here. What more do you want? Let him be or I shall put my mark on someone and not care for the consequence.
Why, Nancy, you're wonderful today. Such talent. What an actress.
Am I? Take care I don't overdo it, or I'm warning you. I'll put my finger on you and not care if I hang with you.
You? Do you know who you are and what you are?
Ah, yes, I know all about it. Who I am and what I am.
Then keep quiet or I'll quiet you for a good long time to come. You're a nice son coming all humane and genteel rubbish. A fine subject for a child as you come to make a friend of.
Lord help me, I am, and I wish I had been struck dead in the street before I lent a hand in bringing him here. From this day forth, he's nothing but a thief, a liar, and all that's bad. Isn't that enough for you without beating him to death?
Now, now, civil words, civil bills, huh, Bill?
Ah, yes, civil words. You deserve them from me. I thieved for you when I was a child half his age and for 12 years since, and don't you forget it.
Well, if you have, it's a living, ain't it?
Look after her, Bill. Look after him, Bill. Man who's got a heart, hasn't he? Joking apart, hasn't he? And though I'd be the first one to say that I wasn't sane, finding it hard to be really as black as they paint. The situation? Can a fellow be a villain all his life? All the trials and tribulation. Better settle down and get myself one. And a wife. And so for me and come for me and go for me and go for me. And naked me the fingers she will wake at me. The money she will take from me. The misery she'll make of me. I think I'd better think it out again. Why, you can keep. Anyway, I'd rather sleep. Anyone left all alone in this world?
starting from now. So how to win friends and influence people. So how? Review the situation. I must quickly look up everyone I know. Title people with a station who can help me make a real impressive show. And I'll own a suite at Claridge's and want a plate of carriages and wave at all the duchesses. The friendliness and munches is befitting of my new estate. Good morning to you, magistrate. I think I'd better think it out again. So where should I go? Somebody. Who do I know? Nobody. All my dearest companions have always been villains and thieves. So in my time of life, should start turning over. Review your situation. If you want to eat, you've got to earn a bob. Is it such a humiliation for a robber to perform an honest job? So a job I'm getting, possibly. I wonder who the boss will be. I wonder if he'll take to me, what bonuses he'll make of me. I'll start at 8 and finish late at normal rate and all but wait. I think I'd better so what happens now? 17. Must come a time, 17, when you're old and it's cold and who cares if you live or you die. The one consolation's the money you may have put by. I'm reviewing the situation. I'm a batting and a batting I shall stay. You'll be seeing no transformation. Transform to be a rogue in every way. I don't want nobody help for me or mate to do the dirt for me. This rotten life is not for me. It's getting far too hard for me. Don't want no one to rob for me. But who will find a job for me? There is no in-between for me. But who will change the plot for me? I think I better think it out again. Hey!
Ah, oh, Mary. And 2 weeks ago it was done. Dear God, it seems an age. I sold myself cheap. I went for a tea set, a pair of sugar tongs, 2 milk pots, some secondhand furniture, and 20 pounds cash. I went cheap. I went reasonably. Why? I did go cheap.
Cheap! You would be dear at any price. And dear enough, I paid for you. Lord above knows that. Are you gonna sit there snoring all day?
Well, although I was not snoring, I shall sit here and laugh, sneeze, cry, and gape as the humor strikes me. Such being my prerogative.
Your prerogative.
I said the word, madam. The prerogative of a man is to command.
And what is the prerogative of a woman in the name of goodness?
To obey. I do wish your dear husband would have taught it to you, and then perhaps the poor soul might still be alive today. Cry, cry, baby. It opens the lungs, cleanses the soul, and most importantly, washes the face. So cry, cry away.
How dare you speak to me like that, you ungrateful lump? Now talk about your promise, if you dare.
Well,
shut up and take yourself out of here before I do something drastic. Well, are you going?
Yes. Certainly, my dear. I have no intention of staying in your presence.
Newcomer.
It's just that you're so damn violent.
Who is that?
I'm your old friend, Sally.
What about it?
Now listen to me. Once, in this very room, in this very spot, I nursed a pretty young creature that was brought into this house with her feet cut and bruised with walking. She gave birth to a baby boy and died.
What about it?
I robbed her. I robbed her, so I did. All she had were around her neck, and it were silver. Well, this it is. The locket. She whispered in my ear that if her babe should live, there might come a day when it might feel proud to hear its mother name. It's my belief she came from a good, rich family.
Rich?
The boy's name. They called him.
Yes?
Oliver.
Oh, Sally, that's so funny! We must have hate! Get back!
Mr. Bumble, we must retrieve that boy.
We must indeed, madam. We must indeed.
Oliver,
Oliver, that was the mic with a large appetite.
Oliver, Oliver, apparently he's from a rich family, and to think we nearly stupidly went and lost track of him. If the truth be told, we'd both be delighted in seeing the back of him.
Oliver, Oliver,
what will we do?
We must give him his due.
And we'll praise the name, somebody named Oliver.
Regarding the boy, Oliver Twist.
Ah, yes. Bumble's the name. Beetle of the workhouse. From which Oliver was brought into the world, cared for. From which he was apprenticed to an undertaker. And from which he ran away from, sir.
Yes, yes, yes. And you know where the boy is now?
Not no more than nobody, sir.
Well, what do you know?
Well, you see, this little trinket was given by the lad's dying mother to my dear wife, Mrs. Bumble, just before she passed on. Oh, you'll have to excuse me. That is, just before the lad's dying mother passed on, not my dear wife.
You're saying that when he left the workhouse, he went to an undertaker's?
Ah, yes, sir. We managed to sell Oliver for £5.
You mean to say you sold him like an animal?
Well, actually, with Mrs. Bumble.
Is that so?
Yes, sir, that is so.
And I shall see to it that neither of us employed in a situation of trust again. You may leave my house.
Sir, this was clearly Mrs. Bumble's doing.
That's no excuse. But you were present on the occasion when the boy was sold and are indeed the more guilty of the two in the eye of the law. For the law supposes that your wife acts under your direction.
If the law supposes that, then the law is an ass. And if the eye of the law supposes that, then the eye of the law is clearly a bachelor and should only be opened by experience. But
Miss Bedwin, look at this locket. You see who it is?
Why, it's Miss Agnes, sir.
Yes, and I have every reason to believe that Oliver was her child.
Sir! I couldn't wait any longer. If I'd have gone away as many would have done, why, you might have been sorry, and not without reason, neither.
I'm sorry if anyone has been rude to you. Can I help you in any way?
I don't know. Can she be trusted?
Yes. Why?
I am the girl who took little Oliver back to old Fagin's on the morning he left this house.
You?
Me, sir. And I wish now that I never would have done it. You see, he mentioned you specially, and I thought if I came to you...
Where is this place you speak of, this Fagin's?
I can't tell you.
Did you perhaps know that Oliver is probably my grandchild?
I didn't know nothing. All I knew was my orders. I had to get him back or suffer for it. You don't believe me. I don't want your pity. I had to come, even though there are those who would murder me if they knew I had been here.
Murder? Where's this Fagin's? Where is Oliver?
I can't tell you. I just wanted you to know that Oliver is safe. I must go back now quickly.
But what can I do about all this? Why can't you tell me where he is? And why do you have to go back to those people? I can call the Bow Street Runners in a moment, and if you tell them what you just told me, they shall see you come to no harm.
Don't you understand? I want to go back. I must go back. You see, back there is a man that I just can't leave. You see, I love him. You don't know what it is like to love someone like that.
I understand.
My dear ladies, do excuse me, but I'm anxious about Oliver. How can you help me?
I can't tell you where he is, but I'll bring him to you. Not here, it's far too dangerous. Can you promise that I won't be watched or followed?
I promise, Solomon.
All right. Between 11 and the time the clock strikes 12, I will walk on London Bridge, and I will bring Oliver.
You can tell the time I find.